Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents They Came to Kill by J.A. Johnstone and William W. Johnstone, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. Chapter 1. Somewhere West of El Paso, 1850. The sweating men, pale under their sunburns, were about to die, and they knew it. They crouched in a shallow gully that ran along a sharp sandstone rise too steep to climb. 20 men now, because two of their number lay out there some 30 yards in front of the gully, their corpses baking in the blistering midday sun. Numerous arrows stuck up from the backs of their blue uniform jackets. They had been the slowest of foot when it came to running for cover, and they had paid the price. Lieutenant Damon Charlton sat with his back against the side of the gully and worked the cork out of the neck of his canteen. He tipped his head back and took a long swallow of the tepid water. No point in worrying about saving it now.
"Lieutenant, what are we going to do?"
one of the men asked. Charlton thought his name was Weatherby, Wellington, something like that. "What are we going to do, Private Weatherby or Wellington or whatever in bloody blue blazes your name is? We're going to die. That's what we're going to do. Quickly and relatively painlessly if we're fortunate. Screaming in agony if we aren't." But of course he couldn't say that, so Charlton responded, "This is a good defensive position, Private. We'll continue to hold it until the hostiles tire of this and depart."
But our horses, sir. Our horses ran away. The Apaches must have them by now. We're at least 80 miles from El Paso. We'll never make it back there on foot."
Knowing what he did of the Apaches, Charlton thought it likely most of those army horses would wind up in the savages' stew pots. They were a nomadic people but didn't travel much by horseback. He had been told by an old-timer that the Apaches trusted their own legs not to give out more than they trusted those of horses. They could run all day when they needed to. Trying to keep his voice level and calm, the lieutenant said, "We'll deal with that when the time comes, Private. Right now, the most important thing is to hold our position, as I said." He heard grumbling along the line and knew some of the men were angry with him. To their way of thinking, he had led them into this death trap, and they weren't wrong. But he'd had no choice. His orders had been to take this patrol into the wasteland west of the western tip of Texas, into what had been the Mexican territory of Nuevo Mexico, until the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo a couple of years earlier, following the end of yet another war. Officially, it was New Mexico territory, owned and controlled by the United States, although the boundaries were fuzzy. Some Texans thought it should be part of that state. The Mexicans still claimed territory in the southern part of the region, but those were just words and documents and lines on maps that could not be pointed to, out where the sun beat down and rattlesnakes and red savages lurked behind every rock. The politicians in Washington, Mexico City, and Austin squabbled over those words and map lines, while soldiers rode out into the harsh landscape to meet death. Charlton corked the canteen. He had no idea how long the Apaches would take in getting around to killing all of them. He supposed he might have time to get thirsty again later, so he might as well save some of the water after all. He heard a low, monotonous sound and realized that one of the men was praying. He almost snapped then, almost shouted at the man that prayer wasn't going to do any good, that there was no one to hear it in this desolation. But Charlton swallowed the word at the last second. Losing his temper wouldn't do any real harm. After all, their situation couldn't get any worse, could it? But it wouldn't accomplish any good either. So why waste his breath? He leaned his head back against the sandstone and closed his eyes. The sun was so bright that didn't make much difference, but his eyelids cut the glare a little. As soon as he did that, however, the same images played out in his mind's eye. The patrol had stopped to rest the horses, when suddenly arrows began to come seemingly out of nowhere.
Several of them struck horses, and the animals went down screaming. Charlton had spotted the gully and recognized it as cover, so he ran toward it, knowing that they didn't have time to mount up. Besides, where would they go? It seemed like the hostiles were everywhere around them, judging by the way so many arrows filled the air coming from every direction. Even though he hadn't shouted any orders, the rest of the men had streamed after him and followed his example in leaping into the gully, all except the two who didn't make it and lay there feathered with arrows. Shots blasted, the echoes rolling across the arid landscape, although the men had fired blindly, unable to contain the reaction to being attacked by invisible foes. The gunfire died away as the arrows stopped coming. It seemed as if hours had passed since then, although Charlton knew that in reality it was more like half an hour. He didn't see any reason to pull out his pocket watch and check the time. It hadn't taken him long to understand what a bad fix they were in. The horses that hadn't been killed in the ambush had run off, spooked by the gunfire and the smell of blood. What kind of army mounts were those? He had asked himself bitterly. On foot, unable to venture out from the scant cover, all the patrol could do was wait. Maybe there would be a miracle. Maybe the Apaches would tire of this standoff and leave. Maybe another patrol would come along. Maybe. With a harsh, incoherent yell, one of the soldiers suddenly scrambled up out of the gully and sprinted across the flats. Another man cried, "Come back here, you fool!" The running man jerked his head around and called over his shoulder, "I'll get the horse!" An ugly guttural sound interrupted that declaration of vain hope as an arrow skewered the man's neck from right to left. He stumbled, twisted, turned all the way around so he was facing back toward the gully. Crouched there, the men saw the torrent of blood that flooded from the soldier's open mouth. Another arrow struck him from behind and drove all the way through his body, so the flint head erupted from his chest. That was wasteful. The neck wound was already fatal. That wild thought careened through Lieutenant Damon Charlton's mind, then he told himself it didn't matter. No doubt the Apaches would retrieve all their arrows once every member of the patrol was dead, which might not be much longer. Shrill yipping war cries came from left and right. The Apaches, who had crawled up unseen until they were within a few yards of the gully, leaped up and charged. Brandishing knives, they dived into the gully. Earlier, Charlton had taken his Colt Dragoon revolver from its holster and placed it on the ground beside him so it would be handy. That saved him the few seconds it would have taken to withdraw the weapon from the flapped holster. He dropped the canteen, snatched up the Dragoon, and eared back the hammer. With the blood thundering through his veins, he didn't even notice the Dragoon's cumbersome weight as he aimed it at the closest Apache and pulled the trigger. The cap and ball's heavy boom hammered Charlton's ears. Powder smoke gushed from the muzzle, and for a second he couldn't see the charging Indian. Then the view cleared enough for him to spot the Apache, stumbling as blood welled from the hole in the middle of his chest. The man's momentum carried him a couple more steps before he pitched forward and landed face down on the very lip of the gully. His arm hung over the edge. His hand still clutched the knife he'd intended to bury in Charlton's flesh. But as the lieutenant watched, the man's nerves stopped working, the muscles relaxed, and the knife slipped from the Apache's grip, dropping to the sandy ground. All that happened in a heartbeat. Charlton cocked the Dragoon again as he shifted his aim. Another Apache came in from the left. Charlton fired. He was a little high this time. Instead of striking the Indian in the chest, the 44 round blew away a fist-sized chunk of his head. That dead man landed on the ground beside the first Apache Charlton had killed. Elsewhere in the gully, several soldiers had managed to fire their muskets, but the weapons were unwieldy and not well-suited for close work. They were actually better as clubs when it came to hand-to-hand fighting, so the men used them that way as they battled frantically for their lives. A few of the Apaches went down with shattered skulls, but there were too many of the savages. They plunged their knives into the soldiers again and again. Men screamed as blood darkened their already dark blue uniforms even more. Some had their throats cut, causing crimson fountains to geyser out from the gaping wounds. The gruesome melee spread along the gully. Lieutenant Charlton twisted to his right. A few feet away, one of the Indians had hold of a soldier's throat with his left hand, while he used the knife in his right to stab the luckless trooper in the chest. The Apache was enjoying this brutal murder too much. He didn't notice Charlton aiming at him until it was too late. The Apache turned his head toward the lieutenant just in time to receive the bullet through his open, yelling mouth. It threw him backward in a lifeless sprawl. Instinct turned Charlton back to the left. The dragoon roared again and a savage doubled over as the slug punched deep into his guts. The revolver cylinder held two more rounds. Charlton had an extra loaded cylinder in his pocket, but he knew he would never have time to switch them out. He started to tremble with the knowledge of his impending death. But he still had those two rounds, he reminded himself. It took two hands to control the weapon, but he cocked and lifted the dragoon and shot another savage in the chest. The man flew backward with arms and legs flailing. Five shots, five dead hostiles, Charlton thought. He probably would have gotten a medal for this if anyone had ever known about it. If he hadn't been destined to have his bones bleach in the pitiless sun, his fate unknown and therefore not mourned. The Apaches were notorious for torturing captives, he reminded himself. He had one round left in the dragoon, and the time had come for him to put it to its best use. He pressed the muzzle against his throat under his chin, his thumb fumbled for the hammer. Something crashed into him from the right, and the dragoon flew out of his hand. As he lay on his side, he cried out and reached for the revolver where it landed on the ground a few feet away. But strong hands pulled him away and rolled him onto his back. A dark shape loomed over him, blotting out the sun. The man drove a knee into Charlton's belly, sickening him and pinning him to the ground. His pulse bloomed inside his head like a drum as he watched the Apache lift the knife above his head. The weapon hung there for a second, poised for a killing stroke. And that heartbeat, which seemed to stretch out for an eternity, Charlton tasted the dirt in his mouth, felt its gritty sting in his eyes. He heard the shrieks of his men as they were slaughtered. He saw the sun reflect off the knife blade, took note of the brass hilt, the bit of bone handle showing where the Apache's sinewy fingers weren't wrapped around it, the round brass pommel on the end. That wasn't a crude knife fashioned by some primitive, he thought. It was a white man's blade, doubtless taken from some corpse, and it was going to claim another life. Instead, the Apache suddenly reversed the knife as he brought it down, and the brass pommel struck Lieutenant Damon Charlton between the eyes, rather than the blade sheathing itself in his heart. The impact was like an explosion in Charlton's brain, a burst of red that flared brighter than the sun, before fading quickly into an all-encompassing black. Chapter 2. MacCallister's Valley, Colorado, 1852. Jamie Ian MacCallister brought the Sharps rifle smoothly to his shoulder and squeezed the trigger. The rifle's thunderous boom blended with the big cat's scream as it launched itself toward Jamie from the rocky knob above him. The heavy caliber bullet caught the mountain lion in the chest, but even though it was a killing shot, it wasn't enough to deflect the beast's flight. Jamie was a big man, but not big enough to withstand the impact of well over 100 pounds of a killer cat. The hurtling body crashed into Jamie and knocked him backward off the ledge. Claws ripped through Jamie's sheepskin coat and raked his flesh. Dying jaws snapped together well short of his throat, instead of ripping it out as the mountain lion had intended. As man and cat both tumbled down the rocky slope, Jamie got his hands against the beast's bloody chest and shoved it away from him. He rolled a few more yards before he was able to grab hold of something and stop his out-of-control plunge. It was a good thing he did. Less than 10 feet away, a cliff dropped off sheer. The mountain lion's body slid over the brink and plummeted 100 feet to crash through the pine branches below. Breathing a little hard, Jamie clung to the rock he had grabbed, looked around for a second handhold, and got a grip on another outcropping. The slope was steep, but once he caught his breath, he climbed it without much trouble, heading up toward the ledge he'd been moving along when the big cat jumped him. He ignored the burning from the scratches the claws had left on his broad, powerful chest. His sharps had caught on the rough ground not far from where he'd dropped it when the mountain lion knocked him off his feet. He was glad to see that. He wouldn't have to climb all the way around to that lower level to retrieve it, as he would have if it had gone over the cliff. A fall from that height might well have damaged the rifle beyond repair, too. Would have damaged him beyond repair for sure, he thought, with a grim chuckle. Then he sobered. He'd caught only a glimpse of the mountain lion as it dived at him, but he had seen that it was a magnificent creature, and a part of him regretted having to kill it. It never would have attacked a human being if it hadn't been hungry from the hard winter not long past, the same sort of hunger that had led it to go after the herd of cattle Jamie had been building up for several years. He had himself a good ranch in what had come to be called MacCallister's Valley, and he wasn't going to let anybody, man or beast, take it away from him. Jamie spotted his broad-brimmed brown felt hat and was glad he hadn't lost it either. He gathered up the rifle and the hat and clambered the rest of the way to the ledge. As he stepped onto it, he looked up at the knob where the big cat had been lying in wait. He'd been tracking the mountain lion all day, and he knew the cat had been tracking him, too. But the deadly competition had come to its end. Jamie slapped the hat against a buckskin-clad thigh and put it on. He reloaded the sharps, sliding one of the long 52-caliber cartridges into the breech, then checked to make sure the Walker Colt was still in its holster on his right hip and hadn't fallen out during this tumble. The revolver was there. With the important things taken care of, he pulled his coat aside and lifted the buckskin shirt to take a look at the wound on his chest. There were four scratches, each a few inches long. They were still bleeding, but not much. Jamie made a face, but the grimace was inspired more by the damage done to a perfectly good shirt than by the wounds themselves. Scars were scattered all over his tall, muscular body. A few more added to their number didn't matter. He took a bandana from his pocket, pressed it over the claw marks, and held it in place with his right arm as he turned and started making his way back down the mountainside. To his left, MacCallister's Valley opened in a broad, impressive sweep. The slopes of the surrounding snow-capped mountains were dark with evergreens. Down in the valley, the snow was gone and lush grass was starting to rise. Wildflowers dotted the meadows. It was the sort of view to take a man's breath away. And it still affected Jamie that way. Although he and Kate had been settled on their ranch for a good number of years. Raised a good number of kids, too. All were grown and out on their own except for the youngest, Falcon. And despite barely being a teenager, he already had the wanderlust in his eyes. Jamie knew that because he had seen it in all the others as they started to come of age. If anything, it was even stronger in Falcon, and he was such a strapping youth that Jamie knew he and Kate wouldn't be able to hold on to the boy for much longer. Jamie had set out from the ranch this morning on horseback and picked up the cat's trail at the last place it had attacked the herd. Not surprisingly, that trail led to the high country, and eventually Jamie had left the horse behind and continued his trekking on foot. It took him the better part of an hour to reach the spot where he had left his mount. The horse was still there and bobbed his head up and down as he let out a whicker of greeting when Jamie stepped close. Then it shied away as it caught the scent of the big cat, or the blood from Jamie's wounds, or both. "Take it easy there, old hoss," Jamie said. "Nothing to worry about. That critter's dead. I'm all right. And we're going home." He slid the sharps back into the saddle scabbard, untied the reins from the sapling he'd knotted them around, and swung up into leather. He wanted to be home by dark. At this time of year, he could still get mighty cold at night. By late afternoon, he came in sight of the sprawling log and stone ranch house and several outbuildings and corrals around it. He also saw something that made his eyes narrow under the bushy graying brows. Four horses he didn't recognize were tied up at the hitch rail in front of the house. The presence of strangers didn't necessarily mean trouble, of course. But even so, Jamie reached down and slid the Walker Colt up and down slightly in its holster, just to make sure it moved freely. Everything looked peaceful. He drew up alongside the horses and saw the U.S. brand on their left shoulders. Those were army mounts, he realized, increasing his puzzlement. He didn't know of any reason why the army would be paying him a visit. The front door opened and Falcon came out while Jamie was dismounting. Despite his young age, Falcon was almost as tall as his father, and the width of his shoulders indicated that they might well be as wide as Jamie's someday. He had an unruly thatch of blonde hair. A grin spread across his face. "Soldiers inside looking for you, Pa." "I can see that," Jamie responded as he leaned his head toward the horses. "What do they want?" "They ain't saying." "Your Ma would correct you if she was out here. They aren't saying." "That's what I just told you," Falcon said. "Anyway, Ma set them down in the parlor and given them coffee and insisted that they stay for supper. They want to talk to you, so I reckon you'll soon find out what they're after." Jamie handed the reins to his son. "Here, put this horse up for me." "Aw, I want to go in with you and find out what this is all about." "You'll find out soon enough, if it's any of your business. Now take the horse onto the barn, rub him down, and give him some grain." "All right." Falcon started to turn away, but paused to look over his shoulder and ask, "What about that mountain lion? I almost plumb forgot to ask about that." "He won't bother our herd anymore." Falcon grinned, clearly proud of his father. "I knew you'd get him." Jamie didn't mention how close the big cat had come to getting him. "One more thing, Pa," Falcon called as Jamie started into the house. "One of those fellas isn't a soldier. At least he ain't dressed like one." Jamie didn't bother correcting his son's language this time. He was too interested in satisfying his own curiosity about the visitors. After all the years of being married to him, Kate knew his step, of course. When he went into the house, she called from the parlor. "In here, Jamie." Jamie took off his hat and coat and hung them on a hook. As he moved into the parlor doorway, his keen-eyed gaze quickly took in the four visitors. Two of them, both in uniform, sat on a divan. A colonel and a major, he noted, so whatever this was, the army was taking it seriously. Another soldier, a lieutenant who was probably an aide to the other officers, was in a straight-backed chair to the side, while a gray-haired middle-aged man in a brown tweed suit occupied an armchair near the fireplace. His face was instantly familiar to Jamie, although the name didn't want to come right away. Kate was in a rocking chair she favored, but she stood up quickly with a look of concern on her beautiful face when she laid eyes on Jamie. He knew she had spotted the rips in his shirt and the bloodstains around them. "Jamie," she said as she took a step toward him. As always, she nearly took his breath away with her beauty, even with that worried expression on her face. "Are you all right?" "Yeah, I just tangled a little with that big cat I went looking for. It's nothing to worry about."
"Nothing to... Let me see."
Without waiting for his permission, she lifted his shirt, which she found rather uncomfortable with strangers in the room.
"Why, that bandana is so bloody it's stuck to the wounds. You come into the kitchen. That needs tending to right now."
"But Kate," he said with a vague wave toward the four men, "we've got company."
"Their business can wait," she said crisply. "Can't it, gentlemen?"
The familiar-looking civilian smiled and said, "Certainly it can, Mrs. MacCallister." To Jamie, he went on, "Now that I've met your wife, Jamie, after hearing so much about her, I'd advise you not to argue with her."
The man's voice prodded Jamie's memory, and a name popped into his head. "Owen. Owen Charlton."
"That's right. I didn't know if you'd remember me or not, but you go on with Mrs. MacCallister.
It's not as if the fate of the entire nation depends on the errand that brought us here, or anything like that. One of the soldiers said, "Actually, sir." Owen Charlton stopped him with a curt gesture, then smiled and nodded again at Jamie, who allowed Kate to lead him out of the parlor. As they went out to the kitchen, he couldn't help but think of Owen Charlton's comment about the errand that had brought them here, and the fate of the nation. Jamie had an unsettling hunch that, despite what Charlton said, maybe those two things were related. Chapter 3. Kate sat him down at the big table in the kitchen, dipped a cloth in a basin of water, and got to work soaking the bandana loose from the bloody wounds. "I thought you were going to find that mountain lion and shoot it, from a distance." "Well, that was the plan," Jamie responded dryly. "But the cat had ideas of its own. We don't have to worry about him going after our stock anymore. I came out on top in that fight." "From the looks of these claw marks, the mountain lion was on top, at least for a while." Jamie changed the subject by saying, "When did Owen Charlton and those officers show up?" "About 2 hours ago. I've been keeping them entertained. The others seem rather stiff and worried about something. But Mr. Charlton is a charming man, or at least pretends to be. Where do you know him from, Jamie?"
"Last time I saw him, he was in uniform, too. A colonel. I did some scouting under his command 7 or 8 years ago over in the Missouri Territory. Reckon he's either retired since then or else he's on some sort of special assignment that's got him in civilian clothes." Jamie winced as Kate peeled the bandana away from the wounds. She had loosened it enough with the wet rag to make it let go.
"Somebody could be carving on you with a bowie knife and you'd never make a sound or show it," she said with a smile. "But let your wife do something that stings a little and you make a face like that."
"Well, it stung more'n a little," Jamie said defensively, then grinned at her.
"It's going to sting even more. I need to clean those scratches with whiskey. None of them look deep enough to require any stitches. I'll just put some dressings on them and bind them in place. Considering all the other scars you have, these won't even be that impressive."
"That's what I was thinking."
As Kate continued working, she said, "I noticed something about this man, Owen Charlton, Jamie. Like I told you, he's very easygoing and charming. But I could see something in his eyes, some sort of pain that's haunting him. Do you know anything about that?"
Jamie shook his head. "Not a blasted thing. You reckon he's sick?"
"Not physically. It strikes me as something that hurts him differently. Something in, well, his soul."
Jamie didn't say anything to that, but he took Kate's words seriously. She was as perceptive a person as he had ever met, and the best judge of character to boot. By the time he walked into the parlor again, with bandages tied around his chest and wearing a clean homespun shirt over them, Falcon had come into the house and was straddling a chair he had turned around. Owen Charlton smiled and said, "I've been telling your son about the advantages of a military career, Jamie. I hope you don't mind." "Nope, but I'm afraid the boy may be too headstrong and fiddle-footed to suit the army."
"But they get to wear uniforms and carry sabers," Falcon protested. "That sounds mighty exciting."
Charlton said, "Unfortunately, if you're an officer, you wind up sitting in a great many dull meetings as well. Like the one I'm about to have with your father."
Jamie took that as a hint and told Falcon,
"I bet you can find some more chores to do. Probably won't even have to look very hard."
"But, Pa..." "Come along, Falcon," Kate said briskly. "I need you to bring in some firewood."
Falcon looked like he wanted to argue, but he knew better than to disobey his mother. He sighed and followed Kate out of the parlor.
"Now we can get down to business," the colonel said.
Charlton said,
"Jamie, this is Colonel Jedediah Hargrove and his aide, Major Aaron Bolton, and Major Bolton's aide, Lieutenant Henry Parkhurst."
Jamie nodded, said, "Gentlemen," and shook hands with all three officers. "Welcome to MacCallister's Valley."
He looked at Charlton. "You retired now, Owen?" Charlton cleared his throat, looked a little uncomfortable, and said, "As it happens, I'm a general. But I'm in civilian garb because I'm here as a special representative of the White House." "President Fillmore sent you?" Jamie asked with a frown. "That's right." News from back east was sometimes slow in reaching MacCallister's Valley, but Jamie knew Millard Fillmore occupied the White House at the moment, with an election coming up later in the year to see if he would continue to do so. He didn't have any particular opinion about Fillmore, politics never having interested him that much, but he wasn't aware of anything bad about the man. It was a complete mystery to him, though, why the president would send Owen Charlton to talk to him. Jamie settled himself in his own rocking chair and said, "This sounds like sort of a deep tale. You'd best start from the beginning, Owen." Charlton sat down, leaned forward, and clasped his hands between his knees. "Are you familiar with the Transcontinental Railroad?" "I know such a thing doesn't exist." "Not yet. But there's been a great deal of discussion in Washington about the building of such a road. And you can imagine, an undertaking like that would be very expensive, with a lot at stake." Jamie nodded. "Not just money. There'd be a lot of power and influence riding on it being a success, too." "Exactly," Charlton said, ticking off the points on his fingers as he went on. "Money, power, and influence. You start talking about those three things and people in Washington sit up and take notice. It doesn't take them long to stake out their positions either. The discussions about a transcontinental railroad have centered around two prospective routes. Each one with its own supporters, I imagine." "That's very true. Some believe that the country would be best served by the railroad taking a northern route across the plains and through the mountains. Others are firmly convinced that a southern route through Texas and then across the territory acquired from Mexico by the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo would be better. Not only that, but it's also thought that Santa Anna would be willing to sell the United States even more land across the southern border. Mexico has been financially strapped ever since he became president again." Jamie scowled. Santa Anna. The name sounded like it tasted bad in his mouth. "That fella has more lives than a cat. How he keeps winding up back in power down there south of the border is more than I can figure out." "That's right. You were at the Alamo, weren't you?" Charlton said. "For a while, before it fell. Good thing I got out when I did, or we wouldn't be sitting here today. But a lot of good men didn't get out, and as far as I'm concerned, their blood is on Santa Anna's hands." The barrel-chested Colonel Hargrove spoke up. "You wouldn't allow your justifiable resentment toward the Mexican president to affect your service to your country, would you, Mr. MacCallister? So far, nobody said a blasted word about how you figure I can serve my country this time," Jamie snapped. "No offense, Owen, but you're just talking around it with all this palaver about railroads." "No, that's really the main reason I'm here," Charlton said. "At the moment, a southern route isn't really feasible because the territory between Texas and California, even with that already officially under United States control, is mostly unexplored and untamed." Jamie had been rocking slightly in his chair. He stopped, peered intently at Charlton, and said, "You're talking about the Apaches." Grim-faced, Charlton nodded. And for a second, Jamie saw what Kate had mentioned earlier. Pain flaring to life in the man's eyes. Jamie's mention of the Apaches seemed to be the spark that had set it off. Charlton's mouth was a thin line as he said, "That's right. Other than the trail up to Santa Fe and the few settlements that have developed along it, Mexico never really brought the area under control. And traffic along that trail has been disrupted many times by raids carried out by the hostiles. There is no trail running from east to west. What it comes down to is that anyone venturing west of El Paso del Norte is risking his life, and in great danger of losing it." "What about the army?" Major Bolton said, "We've tried to establish regular patrols." He stopped short at the look Charlton gave him. Deep trenches had appeared in the older man's cheeks. His blithe, charming manner had disappeared completely. The Apaches must be pacified, at least to a certain extent, before an adequate investigation and survey of the area can be made, Charlton said. President Fillmore has placed me in charge of this effort and instructed me to see it through to a success, no matter what is required.
What's that got to do with me? Jamie asked. His voice was as hard and grim as Charlton's.
There's no better fighting man west of the Mississippi, nor east of there either, for that matter. Jamie Ian MacCallister is one of the best-known frontiersmen in the nation, spoken of in the same breath as Kit Carson and Jim Bridger.
Jamie held up a hand to stop his visitor.
Why don't you go ask those fellows to get rid of the Apaches for you, then?
It's what you're after, isn't it? You want me to take on the whole blasted Apache tribe?
There's something else.
Charlton broke off and turned to look at Hargrove, Bolton, and Parkhurst. If you gentlemen wouldn't mind, I'd like to speak with Mr. MacCallister in private.
Colonel Hargrove frowned. With all due respect, General, the President made us part of this delegation, too.
I'm aware of that, but
I'm asking you, Jedediah. Not as one soldier to another, but man to man.
Hargrove looked at him for a long moment, then got to his feet and jerked his head toward the door.
I believe I'll go smoke a pipe on the front porch. Come along, Major, Lieutenant. The three officers left the room.
Once they were gone, Charlton lifted a hand that trembled slightly and passed it over his face.
I came to you, Jamie, because I know you, and I don't know Carson or Bridger. I know your capabilities, and I know I can trust you.
Jamie leaned forward and said harshly, Spit it out, Owen.
My son is out there, somewhere in that wasteland west of El Paso, and I want you to find him.
Chapter 4 For a long moment, Jamie didn't say anything. Owen Charlton's head drooped forward as he sighed. He stared at the floor, but he seemed to be seeing something else. Finally, Jamie said quietly, I don't remember you talking about a son when we knew each other before, Owen.
Well, we never talked that much about family. We were there to do a job, and we did it.
Charlton forced his head up so he could meet Jamie's gaze again.
I have a son. His name is Damon. He is a lieutenant in the Army. He was posted to the fort that was established a few years ago just across the Rio Grande from the Mexican city of El Paso del Norte.
I've been there, Jamie said. Quite a settlement growing up around it. Some call it Franklin, others just call the whole place on both sides of the river El Paso.
Yes, Charlton nodded. And now that so much of the land west of there belongs to the United States, it's going to be the gateway to the West. But only if that territory can be at least partially civilized.
Which brings us right back to the Apaches. What do they have to do with your son?
More than a year and a half ago, Damon led a patrol out there into the Badlands to try to gauge the enemy's strength and position. They never returned to the post.
Charlton's hands knotted together again, so tightly this time that the knuckles turned white.
Eventually, a stronger force was sent out to search for them. They found the patrol, or what was left of it. The mutilated remains of 21 mounted infantrymen. When the patrol left the fort, it numbered 22 men. A lieutenant, a sergeant, and 20 enlisted men.
Your son's was the body they didn't find, Jamie guessed.
Charlton nodded. That's right. You understand. The elements and the scavengers had not been kind to the men. But none of them wore a lieutenant's uniform. This makes me believe that Damon was captured by the Apaches.
You know it was an Indian attack responsible for what happened to them?
The bodies were full of arrow wounds, Charlton said. There's no other conclusion to draw.
Jamie sat back in the rocking chair and rubbed his chin.
If the Apaches were able to tell that Damon was the leader, yeah, they might have taken him prisoner rather than killing him outright with the others. He didn't say the other things that were going through his mind. The Apaches might have captured Damon Charlton so they could take him back to their village and take their time torturing him to death. They were experts at making a man's death take a long, agonizing time. It was great sport for them. But the chances that Damon might still be alive after more than a year and a half, which was obviously what his father was hoping, were practically non-existent.
"So you can see why I came to you,"
Charlton hurried on.
"I can't ask the army to search for him as a personal favor to me. It just wouldn't be proper."
"But you can't ask me to do that." Charlton flushed.
"I'll beg you to do it if that's what it takes. I'm not too proud for that, Jamie. I'll do anything to find my son and rescue him from those savages, even if it means getting down on my knees and pleading with you."
"Stop that," Jamie snapped. "I wouldn't ask any man to do that, and sure as Blaze is not an old friend." He paused. "But I'm still a mite confused about all this, Owen. You've got an army post, what, 100 miles or so from the area you're talking about? If the army hadn't been able to deal with the Apaches, how in the world do you expect me to?"
"It's because you're not in the army, Jamie. You don't have to worry about rules and regulations. You're acquainted with frontiersmen, top-notch fighting men, and you can recruit any of them you want, as many as you want. I have access to funds that can be used not only to outfit them, but also to pay them for their services. It's our hope that a small, fast-moving force of seasoned Indian fighters can succeed where the army has, at least so far, failed."
Charlton shrugged.
"As you might expect, there's considerable opposition to this idea, too. Colonel Hargrove and the others are here because the president insisted that they accompany me and present the United Front. But they don't like it. They consider it a slap in the face to the army. And as a military man myself, I have to admit it goes against the grain to believe that civilians can do the job better. But that's what we intend to find out."
"And find your son at the same time."
"Yes, the good Lord willing, you'll locate Damon while you're out there."
Jamie didn't believe there was any possibility of that. But what if it was one of his boys? What if it was Falcon who was missing? He would cling to any shred of hope, too. He would never stop thinking there was a chance his son might come home.
"You say I can ask anybody I want to come along with me?"
Charlton's face lit up at that question.
"Does that mean you'll accept the job?"
"Depends on the answer to the question I just asked you."
"Absolutely. Anyone you want. I have complete faith in you, Jamie. And as long as I do, so does the president."
Jamie nodded slowly and said, "All right, then. I'll have to see if I can find the fella I'm thinking about. If I can, and if he agrees to help me round up some other men and will come along himself, I'll give it a try."
"That's wonderful. Who is this man you're thinking of?"
"They call him Preacher." Chapter 5. Santa Fe. The streets, or so the old saying went, were laid out by a drunkard on a blind mule. They twisted this way and that, with no apparent rhyme or reason. And many of them were so narrow that the second-floor balconies of the Spanish-styled adobe buildings on either side almost touched. A man who was athletic enough could leap easily from one balcony to another, as many hombres fleeing from cuckolded husbands had proven over the years. The man called Preacher wasn't the sort to mess with married women, but he was being pursued through the streets of Santa Fe anyway. At least, the men on Preacher's trail thought they were pursuing him. In reality, he was just leading them on, waiting for the right moment to spring his trap. Earlier in the evening, he had spotted them watching him in the cantina where he'd been drinking and enjoying a game of dice. The gods of chance had been kind to the mountain man, and he had walked away from the game with a goodly number of gold coins in his poke. That had increased the interest of the three buscaderos, who sported fancy sombreros and gaudily embroidered jackets and had pistols and knives thrust behind the colorful sashes they wore around their waists.
Preacher would have been willing to bet the trio had never done a lick of honest work to pay for those things. He'd downed one more shot of tequila at the bar after stepping away from the game, and the glass had rattled a little against the hardwood as he set it down. As he wound through the streets, he gave some thought to what had led to the chase. He swayed slightly and announced to the chubby bartender, "Reckon I'll go and turn in for the night."
"Señor Preacher, perhaps you should avail yourself of one of the rooms upstairs," the bartender suggested. "You appear to be a trifle unsteady on your feet."
"I'm fine," Preacher said loudly. "Got me a fine hotel room a few blocks from here, but I appreciate the sentiment, Poncho."
"I worry, because there could be bad hombres abroad in the night."
"Can happen," Preacher broke in. He leaned on the bar for a second, then pushed away from it and turned toward the entrance.
He pushed through the strings of beads that hung over it like a curtain and stepped out into the chilly night. He walked about a block, weaving a little and singing "By the Sad Sea Waves," which he had heard Jenny Lind perform at a concert a year or so earlier during a trip back east. When he paused and looked behind him, he caught a glimpse of three figures silhouetted for a second against the light in the cantina door. They were after him, all right. "You ought to be ashamed of yourself, old son," he muttered to himself, "baiting them poor fellers on like this. Been a while since you had much excitement, though. When there's a hunch of percolating in this old brain that those boys have done this sort of thing before. Probably left more than one poor son of a gun bleeding to death in an alley. So I don't expect to lose a heap of sleep over what might happen here in the next little spell." While he was talking, he turned the corner into an even narrower street. His keen ears picked up a faint whisper of boot leather on hard-packed dirt behind him. His stalkers were still there. Since then, Preacher had led the three would-be robbers on a merry chase, in and out of alleys and cramped streets. Several times he'd figured he was in a good spot for the varmints to jump him, but they held back for some reason. Up ahead, the alley he was following opened up into a plaza, and it wasn't likely they would attack him there. Maybe they had thought better of the idea of robbing him. If they decided to just fade away, he would let them go and head back to his hotel after all. Loud, angry voices coming from the plaza ahead of him took him by surprise. They were in English, too, which in Santa Fe was normally less than a 50-50 chance.
"Away from him, Clementine, or I'll..."
"Filthy hands off!
Let her go!"
"Fellas arguing over some soiled dove," Preacher supposed. "None of his affair, whichever way you looked at it. But tempting those three banditos to come after him hadn't really been his business either. And he'd done that. With them behind him and this fresh trouble up ahead, he didn't hardly know which way to turn. The would-be thieves settled that for him with a rush of footsteps from behind. Now they decided to make their move, he thought, as he whirled around, any semblance of a drunken state vanishing in a heartbeat. Torches flickered in the plaza. Enough light from them filtered into the alley for Preacher to spot the three figures hurtling toward him. He ducked as the first attacker reached him, rammed a shoulder into the man's midsection, and straightened and heaved, throwing the hombre right over his head. The would-be robber let out a startled yell as he flew through the air, a cry that was suddenly cut short as he crashed down on his back. Preacher heard something whipping through the air at him and weaved aside. The club thudded against the ground, and the man wielding it grunted as he stumbled forward, thrown off balance by the missed blow. Preacher backhanded him in the head and knocked him against the wall of one of the buildings flanking the alley. The third man lunged at Preacher, who spotted a tiny glint of torchlight from the long, heavy blade of a knife. He jerked his belly out of the way but felt the razor-sharp edge rake along his buckskin jacket. He reached down and clamped a hand around the man's wrist. He tried to twist it enough so the hombre would let go of the knife, but the man resisted. At the same time, he fumbled with his other hand at the mountain man's throat and got hold of it. They staggered back and forth as they wrestled with each other.
Preacher grasped the wrist of the hand choking him and tried to pull it free, but the varmint was too strong. Preacher understood. This fellow was the biggest and most powerful of the trio, but he had hung back a little, letting the other two jump him first in order to gauge just what they were facing. If those two were able to knock him unconscious or kill him, so much the better. They could have stolen his poke and been gone. When they failed, though, the third man stepped in, figuring that the intended victim had been softened up a mite anyway. That hadn't worked according to plan, so Preacher and the leader were left to battle it out on equal terms. Even worse, the first two were recovering and would be rejoining the fight any moment. Preacher stopped trying to loosen the hand gripping his throat and instead used that fist to punch where he figured his opponent's face was. The blow landed solidly, and Preacher felt the hot spurt of blood across his knuckles. It came from either the man's nose or lips. Preacher wasn't sure exactly where he had hit the son of a gun, but he heard the grunt of pain and felt the man's head rock back under the impact. Preacher hammered another punch home. He pushed hard with his feet and drove the man backward. There had to be a wall behind him somewhere. There it was. Sour breath laden with tequila fumes gusted in Preacher's face as he rammed the man into the adobe wall and pried the hand away from his throat. Just in time, too. Preacher's pulse had been thundering inside his head, and a red haze seemed to drop in front of his eyes, all because of the lack of air. He gulped down a breath, twisted hard with his other hand again, and the crack of bone rewarded him, accompanied by a cry of pain. The knife clattered to the ground. Footsteps sounded behind him. The other two thieves were trying to get back into the thick of it, just as he'd expected. He grabbed the front of the third man's shirt and wheeled around, pulling the stunned hombre with him. A hard shove sent him floundering right into his partners in crime. Skulls wrapped together, legs tangled, and the whole bunch went down in an ungainly sprawl. Preacher's throat hurt as he tried to get enough breath in his lungs. His hands dropped to the pair of .44 caliber Colt Dragoon revolvers holstered on his hips. He could have hauled out those hog legs first thing and ended this robbery before it really got started, but that wouldn't have been sporting. Realizing he didn't care about sport anymore, he leveled the guns at the three men who were struggling to regain their feet and eared back the hammers. That ominous metallic sound was enough to make the thieves stop moving around. "This has gone on long enough," Preacher said. "You fellas savvy what I'm saying?" Panting from exertion and pain, one of the men answered, "We speak your language, viejo. You can call me old if you want, cabrón, but I'm the one on my feet with guns in my hands. You boys are wallowing around on the ground like a bunch of babies." They spat more curses at him until Preacher's sharp voice cut them off. "Listen here. Back there in the cantina, I found out your names." That was a lie, but they didn't have to know that. "I know where to find you, too. If I hear anything about you robbing any more poor folks, I'll hunt you down and there won't be no playing next time. I'll just kill you, one by one. No mercy, no talk. Just death." "That is bold talk for one so old. Who are you?" A faint smile curved Preacher's lips in the darkness, under the drooping, gray-shot, dark mustache. "In the mountains up north, the Blackfeet call me Asesino Fantasma. That name mean anything to you?" One of the men couldn't contain a gasp. "The ghost killer," he said to his friends, confirming that Preacher's notoriety had made it that far south. "They say he has slain thousands of Indians, and my share of white men, and Mexicanos too," Preacher said. "So you know I mean what I say, and you know I can do it. If you don't want to wake up some morning with your throat cut from ear to ear, you best not stray off the straight and narrow from now on. Comprende?" The biggest of the trio sat up and asked in a surly voice, "Why does the famous ghost killer not go ahead and slay us?" "Oh, I'm sure you boys deserve it. Tell you the truth, that's how I figured this little dust-up would end. But I guess I'm just feeling generous tonight. And I've already killed so many no-good skunks this month, I reckon it gets old after a while." Preacher gestured with one of the dragoons. "Now vamonos while you got the chance." He kept them covered as they got up and scuttled away along the alley. He really should have killed them, he mused. As he'd told them, they no doubt had it coming for past crimes. But nobody had appointed him judge, jury, and executioner, and he'd drifted into Santa Fe to enjoy himself, not to clean up all the crime in its narrow winding streets. Although, he thought, as his eyes narrowed, that might be an interesting chore for another time. He had just holstered the Colts when a scream came from the nearby plaza. During the scuffle in the alley, he had lost track of the squabble going on in the plaza. Obviously, it had escalated. The woman screamed again as Preacher wheeled in that direction. "Dadgummit," the mountain man said. "One fracas don't hardly get over with before the next one breaks out." It had always been that way, so he didn't know why he should expect anything different. With his hands resting on the butts of the dragoons, he strode toward the plaza. Chapter 6. It was late enough in the evening that the young girls no longer strolled about the plaza with their dueñas, trying to catch the eye of any young caballeros who happened to be around. In fact, the open square was deserted except for half a dozen people who were clustered at one side. The young woman who had screamed was backed up against a wagon with two mules hitched to it. She was quiet because her hands were pressed to her mouth in horror. A few yards away, a young man struggled in the grip of a much larger hombre who had his arms pinned behind his back. The youngster was trying not only to get loose, but also to avoid the fists of another man who stood there slugging away at him. Two more men stood to the side, grinning and letting out little whoops of encouragement from time to time. Preacher had never laid eyes on any of those folks, but he knew 4-1 odds when he saw them, and he didn't like that at all. Luckily, Preacher could make those odds even.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.